been around here. I don't know if you've been coming for years and years, or maybe back since you were a kid, or maybe this is your second or third week with us, but we're about to do something big. This church that we're involved with, they're about to do something that this town's never seen. And the next month, we're going to be talking about what this thing is, about what part you can play in it. And we're going to be looking at the Bible, the stories that it tells. What they did was they followed God, and that's what we're going to be doing. We're going to be looking at the book of First Chronicles. We're going to be looking at other stories of faith. You know what I hate? You know what drives me crazy? Is when you're just hanging out talking to somebody and they say something about a party that they're going to, a birthday party, an event that they're heading to, and you sit back and you think to yourself, dang, why wasn't I invited to that? You know? I mean, what a feeling to be sitting in that moment and to realize that you're not a part of something that's going on. I don't know what's worse, if it's that feeling or when you get home the next day to find your invitation in the mail and all the thoughts that you had about the person holding the party or the event or the people that were going. You know, that feeling of being left out, of feeling all alone, like maybe you're the only one that wasn't invited out. Then when you know you're involved and the different sensation that you get, to know that you belong, to know that you're a part of something bigger, that you're connected with people, it's just a cool feeling. It's something that lets you know that you belong, and that's why we're here. That's why I wanted to invite you to be a part of this thing that we're doing. This is your invitation. Your invitation to be involved with what's happening. Your invitation to hop on board with what God's doing. Your invitation to pray for our leadership, to pray for the future of this community. This is your invitation to be a part of something big. As I look at scriptures, I look back to David. What he did was he had an invitation. He talks about it in the book of 1 Chronicles. Let me turn to it. It says this: David summoned all of the officials of Israel to assemble at Jerusalem, the officers over the tribes, the commanders of the divisions in the service of the king, the commanders of thousands and commanders of hundreds, and the officials in charge of all the property and livestock belonging to the king and his sons, together with the palace officials, the mighty men, and all the brave warriors. Now, I've read this a number of times, and I've thought about what this was like, and I guess at first I thought of a dinner, you know? A couple dozen people gathered together. And then as I looked at it a little bit closer to it, it's not talking about a couple dozen people. It's not even talking about a couple hundred people. See, a few chapters earlier, David was looking and figuring out who he had it, and it talks about there being over a million warrior men in the tribe. Over all the nation. Over a million men able to fight. So millions of people that these commanders and these officials represented. And so it wasn't just dozens. It was more like hundreds. Hundreds of people invited out to hear about something that David had been working on and praying about for years and years and years. What must that have looked like? It wasn't in a dinner. It wasn't even in a banquet hall. Can you imagine a huge stadium filled with all the most important, mighty, powerful people of Israel coming to hear David? Imagine what it must have been like, wondering what the news was going to be, wondering what this announcement was going to be about. The electricity that would have been running through the place. You guys know what it's like. You know that feeling of being in a crowd of hundreds and feeling the energy that comes from those people, the excitement, the anticipation of what's going to come. And then it says this: David entered. Imagine that entrance. All these people waiting for David, and David comes in and walks up front. I wonder if it would have been a cheer, if it would have been excitement and yelling and screaming, or I wonder if it was complete silence. And then David steps out in front of all the people and he says this: "Listen to me, my brothers and my people."
Listen to me, my brothers, my people.
Catch that? "Listen to me, my brothers, my people," he goes on. I had in my heart to build a house as a palace of rest for the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord, for the footstool of our God, and I made plans to build it. But then God said to me, you are not to build a house for my name because you are a warrior and have shed blood. This announcement, something that he'd been working on and praying on literally for years, the excitement that he had, and maybe even the disappointment that you would have seen on his face when he said, I had plans. I've had plans for years to do this thing, but God told me different. He said, you've shed too much blood. You've been a warrior in your day. But instead, he says, I've made plans for your people. I've made plans for your sons, and I've made plans for your throne to be established forever. What he's really talking about is Jesus, not just Solomon, his son, but to establish a kingship that would run the lineage all the way down to Jesus himself. But this day, his announcement was about Solomon. He was saying, Solomon is going to be building this temple. In fact, I have gathered millions of dollars in gold, in silver, tons of it, literally tons of silver, tons of gold that I've set aside to build this temple for our God. What an announcement. But that wasn't the biggest deal. See, what he was saying was, I want to invite you, leaders. I want to invite you, my brothers, my people, to be a part of this with me. I mean, how cool is that? He goes on, David talks about how God himself had inspired the plans for this temple, about how David had prayed about it and had sat down maybe at a table to draw up his plans, and God orchestrated in his mind what it would all look like. As he drew it out and planned it out, it was directly from God's inspiration that this thing was going to take place. And for the people, just ordinary folks, to be invited by the king to be a part of it, that's a cool thing. As I look at this whole process, and you don't know all the history behind this building, but I know in my place that God has put one thing in line after another, and that I get to be a part of it. You know, and that's the invitation to you. You know, what part can you play in this? Maybe you're not going to bring tons of gold and silver. I know I'm not. But you'll bring your unique stuff. And I want you to journey with us over the course of the next month. To ask God, God, what role do you want me to play in the future of Florence Christian Church? You're part of something bigger than yourself. And I got to tell you, you can't do it on your own. It has to be something that offers God a place in your life. A place for you to stretch your mind and see things in yourself that maybe only God sees that you couldn't see on your own. I heard earlier this week a story of a Michigan football team that went to the Rose Bowl, and I don't know the dates, I don't know the exact speech, but the coach was in the locker room and he was telling the team, this is our game. This is it. This is what we've been playing for, to get to the Rose Bowl, and today is our day to go out there and take this. In fact, we're not going to come back into this room until we have a win. And he got his team riled up, and he said, are you guys ready? And they were saying, yeah, and they're cheering. And he said, all right, on the count of three, we're going to charge out of here. And they started getting louder and louder, and the energy was building. And it counted one, two, three. And the team stands up roaring and runs out the door, and the coach is standing there watching his team rush past him as they run out of the locker room. And then all of a sudden he hears what seems to be splashes, and he realizes that the team had run out the wrong door and half of them were in the swimming pool. You see, if we try to do this thing on our own, we'll just end up all wet. But if we do this thing with God's power, with God's vision, with him behind us, that we can do amazing things. And you know what? The adults in this church, they can't do it without you. Nothing that happens here is done without you guys. I can't do it without you. So this is your invitation to get involved in something bigger than yourself.
He loves us. Oh, how he loves us.